Dr. Sam Osmanagic, and this is May of 2019. I'm in Eastern Turkey. Behind me is arguably the most impressive and the most important archaeological site in the world. It is known under the name Gobekli Tepe. Back in the 1960s, first British archaeologists and then in 63, archaeologists from the US came to the area, they found some ceramic pieces, and they, of course, established that this was an archaeological site. For them, it was just medieval site. And then University of Chicago with the local museum started doing some very limited excavation. They realized it is a little bit older. But then, very soon, they gave up on it. Back in 1993, German archaeologist Dr. Klaus Schmidt came to the area upon finishing one of his archaeological assignments, and then he realized this might be very intriguing place to dig. Next year, 1994, he started digging. At that time he was part of the German Archaeological Institute of Istanbul. And very soon, during his 20 years of being at this site, he became one of the most popular archaeologists ever, even more popular than Schliemann from the end of the 19th century. Why was that? With the help of the first German Archaeological Institute from Heidelberg, and then later on the one from Berlin, who were financing this site, they realized that they are in the front of the oldest known structure in the mainstream archaeological world. How did they figure that one out? They started digging here on the top of this hill. Now this hill has a commanding view of the area, tens of kilometers around us. And where are we exactly? We are at the place where such two important areas meet. One is Minor Asia or Anatolia, today's Turkey, and the other one is Mesopotamia. Mesopotamia between two rivers, two major rivers from the ancient past, Tigris and Euphrates. So this is the place where a lot of activities have been going on in the distant past. People coming from east, going to the west, and vice versa, they were coming to this area. Now, when he started digging, as we can see below us, he went about 15 meters deep, discovering these big megaliths. What is a megalith? It contains two Greek words, mega, big, and lithos, rock. So big rocks, as we can see, these are upstanding rocks, megaliths. They are nicely shaped. Most of them have the shape of letter T. Now, in the past, in the last 30 years, from 1980s, a similar style was discovered here and nowhere else on the planet. T-shaped blocks. The biggest blocks are just on the opposite side. They are about 5.5 meters in height. We can calculate its mass real quick. So we have 5.5 meters, about 60 centimeters by 120, so it is about 5.7 to 3.5, so it is about 8 to 10 tons. 8 to 10 tons. Now, another intriguing thing, the biggest rocks are the deepest. What does that mean? Those who came later, they were smaller and smaller. And above us, there is even a higher area with the smallest blocks. Now we know, due to the radiocarbon datings, that those that are, you know, closer to the surface, they are of course younger. What they teach us in schools is the theory of evolution. Before we were primitive, and with the time we were developing more and more. We were becoming more intelligent, technologically advanced, and so on. So we were capable of carving and shaping bigger and bigger blocks. Here is opposite. So the theory of evolution does not really apply here, because the biggest pieces and the most impressive piece, years of his work, he realized that this place is a temple. Now, what is a temple? According to the dictionaries, temple is a place where people do their religious or spiritual ceremonies. According to the mainstream science, spiritual ceremony means you do the process of sacrificing, or you know, you bring certain stuff to the gods. Well, if you look at the place, there is not a single proof that it was used as a temple. I don't think that anybody was sacrificed here, and I don't think that this was a temple. There is also a theory that there was a roof here. However, we can see different elevations. There is no way that you could have one or two roofs. The second thing, there is not a single remnant of those potential roofs. So I kindly disagree with Dr. Klaus Schmidt and the German Archaeological Institute that this was a temple, because it was not. Mainstream archaeology, when they don't have answers, they use things like religious purposes, ceremonies, you know, spiritual or temples. We don't have proof for that. How come after 20 years of the work they could not figure out what was the real purpose of this site? The reason why, it was only archaeological work. Archaeologists do not have a knowledge, they don't have an engineering mind to get to the real, true purpose of the site. Now, let's go back to those blocks. As you can see, some of them are plain, flat, nothing on them. However, some of them have a lot of, you know, zoomorphic figures. Now, we have different animals. We have lions, we have wild boars, we have hyenas, we have reptiles, we have snakes, we have some even dinosaur-type animals. What does that indicate? It indicates that we don't have domestic animals here. Without domestic animals, it is telling us that this is not the phase that belongs to the agricultural society. Very important. When it comes to the dating, Dr. Klaus Schmidt did basically 2+2 dating. Two dating were done on the filler material. What filler material? Well, according to him, there were two phases of these structures. According to me, there were three phases. So, first the conventional view. He's saying two phases. The first phase is the phase when they built, erected those blocks, and they connected them, according to him, with his drywalls. Rather primitive. And the second phase was when the whole site was covered in hurry, as he claimed, with the filler material. Filler material is this one right here. You can see rocks, pebbles, you can see soil, you can see clay, you can see sand. Well, when he found organic material in the filler, what kind of organic material? He found ground animal bones and ground human bones. The age was about 10,000 years BC, before Christ. So it gives us 12,000 years. Well, officially, you go to the non-scientific sites like Wikipedia, you can read it is 11,600 years old. Wrong. Why they are doing that? Because they want to be younger than the end of the last ice age, which was about 11,500 years back. If you go more than that, oh, this is the border that conventional science does not want to cross. They want to stay in what they call Neolithic times. Neolithic, 11,500 years. 12,000 plus, Paleolithic, primitive caveman, not capable of doing anything here, really. So, what we have here, we have a site which is 12,000 radiocarbon date, but this is not a calendar age. Why not? Because calendar age, you need to add approximately 15%. 15% on 12,000 years is about 1,800 years. So 12,000 plus 1,800 is 13,800 years. So now we are going to the Paleolithic times. Conventional science does not want to hear that. But this is the fact. So the filler material, when they closed this place, is so old. Now, the second source of dating were the plasters that they found on those megaliths. The plasters produce two dates, and both of them are around 9500 BC. Again, 11500, when you account for 15%, you are coming to 13500, almost 14,000 years. That's why this place is so interesting for me. And that's why it is so annoying and unpleasant for the mainstream science. So this is the dating. Many people will try to reduce this dating to 8,100 years, like they are doing already, and eventually to 5,000 years, trying to prove that this is typical chronology that we have in the last 5,000 years. Everything started with Sumerians, Babylon, Akkad, Assyria, ancient Egypt, Hittites, ancient Indians, so on. Wrong. This belongs to the previous cycle. This was the cycle which is also known as pre-pottery Paleolithic times. Well, Dr. Klaus Schmidt is trying to put it in pre-pottery Neolithic A times. It's even older than that, Paleolithic. 6 years ago, in October of 2013, I first came to this site. I came here, everything looked so much differently. At that time, they started protecting the site with the ugly wooden posts. Everywhere was wood. You could not see almost anything. Today, when Turkish government took over, it's much nicer. They spend much more money, but then you can see the whole site. You cannot touch it, and it is not supposed to be touched. You can observe the whole thing. Right now, we have 8 enclosures, or 8 circles, with the 4 big circles behind me, A, B, C, and D. And the other one, up to letter H, are behind us. But those first 4 are really the most impressive. And they were completely buried in the filler material. What is the difference in explanation between me and Dr. Klaus Schmidt when it comes not only to dating, because I claim they are much older, but also to the way they constructed? He's talking about 2 phases, I'm talking about the 3. The first phase, they were erecting in a very nice way, precise way, careful way, those megaliths. They were part of the bedrocks, so they were very stable. The second phase, they were adding those rather primitive dry walls. Now, dry walls in some cases, but in some cases they were real walls because they were connected with the mortar. Now, Klaus Schmidt and his team, when they came here, when they experienced the mortar, now they had a big problem because mortar is very hard to keep it there. Why? Because of the water, the rain is coming, the mortar is eroding. The second problem is the wind. Again, it is eroding. And the third problem, the insects. Insects go there, so it is eroding. So, this for me was the second phase, which has nothing to do with the first perfect phase when they built those, as they call them, enclosures. They did not have roofs, but they had only those blocks. And the third phase, of course, when they covered it. And they covered it before the end of the last ice age, which tells me that they knew that the catastrophe was coming. The primitive caveman could not know that, but someone with a very advanced knowledge of astronomy could. Yeah. So they knew that. Why did they do that? Well, probably they did it in a hurry, they covered it. Did they think they are going to use it in the future? Maybe. Now, we can see that some of them have been broken. It is possible that the original builders left the site, and then the tribes that they were coming, without understanding of the site, they were trying to damage it, ruin it, or even destroy it. Now, we are coming to the most important questions of all. What is the purpose of this site? Archaeology and archaeologists do not know, they don't have a formal knowledge to understand the sites like this one here. I have done some measurements at 2 different places using several different instruments. The first place was control place, and it was done at the beautiful visitor center which they just opened in 2018. Even though the content, the movie they are showing, has absolutely nothing to do with the site and the primitive, half-naked tribal people who are shown as the builders. But when you see the site, it is a big difference than what I encountered here 6 years ago. So the first measurement was done there. So this is what I measured. I measured the level of the life energy using experimental life meter, which was made in the US, which is made on William Reich's research from 70 years back, and now they make those instruments. They measure the level of life energy or orgone energy. In Eastern tradition, it is called the prana or chi energy. Over there, it was at the level of 22, on the scale from 0 to 122, which is rather high, because in the contaminated cities, it is about 10%. The second thing I measured was the concentration of negative ions. Negative ions are very beneficial to human health. Over there, I measured only 300, which is the average value when it comes to the cities or villages. Positive ions, which is not so positive for us, they were at the level of 500. The bad thing, more positive than negative ions. The next thing, magnetic fields. It was stable at 45 nanotesla, and this is something that you can also find in the cities and the villages. Infrasound, range 20 to 40 hertz, nothing special. Ultrasound, 10 to 20 kilohertz. Now, this site here, we are almost on the top of this Gobekli Tepe hill. Magnetic field, which really surprised me, it goes anywhere from 41 to 90 nanotesla. What does that mean? It means that this site is energetically active. So it is alive. Even though majority of it is still covered, energetically it is still active. So somebody had the knowledge of energy properties of this place. They were usually building megalithic sites, the pyramid site and the tumulus site, on the top of the energy potent places. So what do we have here? Hard to say, but we should have some of this stuff, either underground water flows or cavities on different levels or quartz crystal. So we should have some of those stuff, including some minerals or iron, source of the electromagnetism. So out of 5 or 6 sources, we should have here at least 1, 2, or even 3. The material they use is the limestone. Limestone is very common material in the radius of 100 kilometers. However, only on this particular hill, we have this crystalline limestone, which is much harder than limestones around us. If you have such a hard material, you have to have some very superior tools to shape it. And you see how it's beautifully shaped those blocks are. So with the sandstone, with the limestone, with a lot of quartz in there, it is an ideal medium to transfer the energy from one form to another, from electromagnetic field to the ultrasound, from the ultrasound to electricity, through the piezoelectric effect. So that the first element that I measure, the magnetic field, is the most important. The second one, ultrasound, rather stable, 12 to 15 kilohertz, infrasound, 0 to 40 hertz. Now, this is interesting. If you have some activities at the level 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, now, these extremely low frequencies are very good for humans. They are good for the meditation process. They are good, you know, for the astral projections. So somebody created the place that was excellent for the spiritual activities. Not the way the archaeologists are talking about spirituality and the religious and the other stuff which they don't understand, but about development of spiritual senses, about activating some of those senses. The life energy, next thing, if you remember, control place, it was 22. Here we have 40. On the scale from 0 to 100, it is at the level of 40, meaning it is 2 times better to be than any other place around. And finally, negative and positive ions. Positive ions, only 150 positive ions per cubic centimeter. Very low quantity. However, negative ions at the level of 900, meaning it is almost 3 times higher than at the contaminated places. 900 it's a good level. Of course, it is not beneficial level, like, let's say, level of Bosnian pyramid tunnels, which is about 20 to 50,000. But 900 is very beneficial, and the good thing is it's many more negative ions than positive ions. What does that mean? Once you have this free electrical charge in the air, they can start doing their job. They can start removing viruses and bacteria from your body. They can make you physically, mentally, and spiritually pure. They can raise the level of oxygen in your body. So I would say, and this is for the first time ever in the last 20 years that somebody has done these energy measurements. So I'm proving that this was site which was the reason why it was built, it was because of the energy properties. So it is energy related, some type of the energy machine. So I would say archaeologists, historians, anthropologists, geologists will need to open these projects for the engineers and the physicists, and the serious scientific exploration will have to be done here to understand this site. When it comes to the builders, instead of taking a bedtime stories about the primitive caveman having nothing to do and, you know, shaping and carving all these beautiful megaliths, they should realize that by using the filler material with so much of the ground human bones, it probably tells us something about approach and attitude the real builders had toward Homo sapiens, who, by the way, didn't even live here. This is a huge place. We have 8 circles. When I spoke to Dr. Klaus Schmidt, he told me 2 important things. The first one was that the site was probably between 15 and 18,000 years old, and the second one, there are probably dozens, if not 100 circles, and not a single residential house kilometers around. What does it tell us? It was not built by, you know, those hunters and food gatherers 14,000 years back. They had nothing to do with this site. So out of 5 questions in archaeology, let's see what we had answered today. What is this? Now, this is some type of the energy machine. Who? We don't know who. But all the options are open. Humans, non-humans. Number 3, when? It was the end of the Paleolithic era, not Neolithic. Number 4, how? More advanced tools that we know them. And number 5, why? The ancients, when building such sites, they never had only one purpose. It was always multi-purpose. Communication, health protection, spiritual advancement, improve the molecular structure, water, food, immunity, auric field, and other bioenergetical fields. So now we are getting closer to answer the mystery of Gobekli Tepe. We're very happy to see the Turkish government finally took this location and they are starting to take care of it, investing a lot of money. But what they will need to do, they need to go with the open-minded scientists, engineers, and physicists to understand this place. The year 2019 is the year of Gobekli Tepe, rightfully here in Turkey, but what I'm saying is they need to get the full understanding of this site, and they will be even more proud than stating this was 0 point of time because it was not, or this was a temple because it was not. Thank you.